Please be seated. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and on behalf of President and Mrs. George Bush, the George Bush Presidential Library Foundation, welcome to the George Bush Library Center here at Texas A&M University. My name is Fred McClure, and I serve as the Chief Executive Officer of our foundation. I know we have some guests in the audience this evening who are not members of the foundation. We would encourage you to join, that we can continue having programs like tonight. Think about it. You could repurpose some of your Cyber Monday instincts toward Bush41.org or tomorrow's Giving Tuesday, so take your pick. We'd love to have you as a member of our foundation so that we can continue to have these kinds of programs and that you can be invited to them. Before we begin our program, please allow me to officially introduce the only reason that we're here this evening, President and Mrs. George Bush. Also, please acknowledge my fellow keepers of the Bush flame, the Executive Director of the Bush Library and Museum, Mr. Warren Finch, and the Dean of the Bush School of Government and Public Service, Ambassador Ryan Crocker. Gentlemen. After tonight's program, we will walk across the plaza to the library and museum where we will have a reception and a ribbon-cutting ceremony and open the National Parks Photography Project, which celebrates the 100th anniversary of the National Park Service. Now let's take a look back at what our national parks have given to us, and I think you will enjoy this film and some photos to follow. Nine of the national parks, 47 of which were in the lower 48, and the remaining 12 outside the continental United States. A native of Houston, American photographer Mark Burns displayed a strong affinity toward photography as a child. He began work in 1978 as a sports photographer, but a decade later, he shifted almost exclusively to commercial photography. His work has appeared in Time Magazine, The Sporting News, The Wine Spectator, and Wine Enthusiast, to name a few. The work you will see next door is done in black and white, giving the pictures a timeless quality, much like the early photographers who photographed the parks in the early years in the era of black and white photography. I guarantee you, you will find them to be stunning. President Bush has compared Mark to a modern day Ansel Adams. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Mark Burns. You've met the photographer, now let's meet the filmmaker. When we decided to do this National Parks exhibit, we began thinking about who else might have visited our nation's parks and preserved them in some sort of special way. We turned our attention to a filmmaker who has been making film documentaries for nearly four decades. Since the Academy Awards nominated Brooklyn Bridge in 1981, Ken Burns has directed and produced some of the most acclaimed historical documentaries that we have witnessed. The Civil War, baseball, jazz, the Statue of Liberty, Thomas Jefferson, Unforgivable Blackness, the Rise and Fall of Jack Johnson, the Roosevelts, An Intimate History, among others, and the National Parks, which you saw an excerpt of, America's Best Idea. Ken's films have won 14 Emmy Awards, two Oscar nominations. The late historian Stephen Ambrose said of Ken's films, "More Americans get their history from Ken Burns than any other source." Future works in progress include films on Jackie Robinson, the Vietnam War, the history of country music, Ernest Hemingway, and the history of stand-up comedy. Born in Brooklyn, New York, Ken is a graduate of Hampshire College in Amherst, Massachusetts, and is the recipient of 30 honorary degrees. Please welcome the co-founder of Florentine Films, Emmy-award-winning filmmaker, Mr. Ken Burns. Ken.
Hey, sir.
Thank you all again for being here. We're going to have a little chit-chat with two guys who've kind of seen it all, if you understand what I mean. And we'll have a little back and forth, and hopefully we can learn a little bit more about their work having to do with our America's treasures. Let's start with you, Mark, since this is your photography project that you've put together. Where did you get the idea for this National Parks photography project?
That's a fabulous question with Ken Burns sitting here, because it was a combination of things. First of all, I love black and white photography. I have, since being a young child, I've loved traveling out west with family vacations, and always used to take black and white photographs, and wanted to photograph mountains and ghost towns and things like that. So I had that kind of affinity from a very young age, but I had done the wine exhibit here and talked with Gene, and the idea came up of doing another project, and at that time Ken's film had come out, and I actually bought the book also, and in reading the book it really profoundly kind of hit me that it was the work of the early painters and photographers, the Thomas Morans, who I love, William Henry Jackson, the photographer, Crawford Watkins, photographer, Thomas Hill, painter, Albert Bierstadt, painter, those the works that they were doing back then in the 1860s, 70s, 80s, into the turn of the century, were being viewed back east. And in a lot of cases, those works helped, reading this, helped to create the lands being declared as protected in national parks. And that really, as an artist, profoundly kind of, I went, wow, I'm a photographer. I think around this centennial, I want to go out and do a project to photograph all 59 parks, and I quickly said this is perfect for black and white to me, because that's my bridge back to the past century, to do it in black and white, because it I love it, and I think it is that timeless bridge back to what they were doing back then photographically. I'm probably more inspired by the early artists or the painters' work. You know, I think that I look at those, and that's where I really see, you know, some of the compositions that I went out and looked for. I spoke with a woman who did a book in Santa Fe about artists versus photographers, and you know, I was in Zion National Park and had this beautiful scene in front of me, except there's a dead tree that's falling across the front of it. You know, and I'm saying, now if you're painting that, you just don't put the dead tree in there. So, I can't go down there with a chainsaw. I can't do it.
Ken, any of us who've seen any of your great work knows that you got to settle in for the long haul, because it's going to be big.
Yeah, you're lucky you just saw the first 15 minutes instead of all 14 hours.
I know,
right?
I know.
Well, you'll be out at 8 tomorrow morning.
Well, that might work. That might work. So this was a 6-part series. And how long did it take you to film this project?
Well, we started 10 years out from when it was broadcast. In 99, we had the idea. We said yes in our hearts, which is, you know, like Mark and his extraordinary work, so much a part of this, that you have to invest not your head, not your wallet, but your heart, first of all, and say yes. And we did in 99, and then spent the next years, you know, we filmed from the gates of the Arctic to the dry tortugas, from Acadia in Maine, where the first rays of sunlight hit the United States every morning, to the Hawaii volcanoes, and all around. And that took a lot of time and digesting. And what we didn't want to do is tell the familiar travelogue or nature film. There are many of those. What we thought was most interesting, and I think which caught Mark's attention, was that how did they come about? You know, we're about manifest destiny. You know, Americans look at a river and think dam. They look at a stand of trees and think bored feet. They look at a canyon and wonder what mineral wealth. And yet somehow in the middle of all of that manifest destiny, manifesting itself, we decided that part of our destiny would be saving these extraordinary places and setting aside a little bit so that you could see and experience what it was like at the beginning of human habitation in this world, but also even before that, because they tell this grand geological story. So we worked collecting the stories and finding out that behind every national park there was incredible stories that were geological and scientific. They were personal, they were sometimes spiritual. I mean, you saw the first episode is called The Scripture of Nature. I mean, that is the catechism. We think of ourselves in America as being founded on political liberties, and we were, but we also said that human beings could worship God as they saw fit. And what Americans had to offer were not the great cathedrals of stone made by man that their European, mostly European ancestors had, but these new cathedrals of nature, in which it was postulated by Emerson and Thoreau, and then later John Muir and others, that you could find God as easily in nature, capital N, as you could in those cathedrals made by stone. And that was a revolutionary idea, and they reach a kind of they connect at some point in the middle of the Civil War in 1864, when there are 2,000 casualties a day coming back to the North, that Abraham Lincoln approves of the passage of a bill that Congress passes that is setting aside this place in the Sierra Nevada called Yosemite and starts in motion this extraordinary thing. And finally, several decades later, we decided somebody ought to take care of that. And that's the National Park Service, and that's 100 years ago, which brings us here. But we were compelled by the love of these places, and not just how beautiful they are, and how they, there's a wonderful paradox, and I'll shut up, that you stand on the rim of the Grand Canyon, and you experience your atomic insignificance, one writer said. And yet, at the same time, you are inspirited and made larger, just as the egotist amongst us is diminished by his or her self-regard. And there's something magical about that, to be aware of how small and insignificant you are, but then to participate in something bigger than yourself. That's a great bargain, and we are all the co-owners of this. And all we have to do is every once in a while go and make sure it's been taken care of and then give it to our.
I'm going to ask both of you the same question. This is probably an unfair question, but we'll give it a whirl. So what was a typical day and during doing both of your projects?
Well, for me, as a filmmaker, you're always after the special light that takes place usually at dawn or at dusk, the magic hour it's sometimes called in our business. And you spend an awful lot of time. And so inevitably, and this is one of the great hard lessons of the national parks, inevitably you're getting up at 2:45 or 3 a.m. in some sort of not first-class hotel, someplace in which you then have to drive 75, 80 miles in the dark at a place you've maybe scouted before, and you're trying to find, you've got a compass, you know where the sun's going to come up, you know when it's going to come up, and you've got it all timed, and then you're trying to figure out how the light's going to hit, what it's going to do. And we had time and time again, we would be sitting there in the half darkness, running around from one place to another. No, let's go over here. And we're going over here, and finally we got the camera set up. We take this amazing dawn, the light comes up, and there's a sign that the Park Service has said, Inspiration Point, or Good Photographic Point. And you realize, before you do anything in a national park, you get out the map, and wherever they say, yeah, Artist Point, yeah, or Inspiration Point, go there. Wow. You cannot make a mistake, and all of our crazy fumbling, and that's another great stern lesson of the national parks, but we would do that. That's a typical day, is to go there, and sometimes, a cloud obscures it, and you get skunked, and you turn away, or you wait 9 hours. You go into the visitor center, and you film the handful of archives they might have, and hear the stories of the people who started it, and then do the sunset. And these are, in summers, these days go on for 15, 16 hours.
Well, he's rolling film. You're doing, stills, so.
Yeah, it's what he said, it sounds mirrors exactly my experience. I mean, I had, most mornings the alarm was going off at 2:45 to 3, and if you're driving 75 miles from a Best Western or something to, to wherever the first spot you picked in the morning to get started in would be. I tried to be set up every morning 1 hour before sunrise was my goal to get where right. I wanted to be. So I wasn't super rushed when I got there. You kind of get things out and, you know, and just wait for the light to happen and be set up and ready. So that's exactly, though, my experience. And then if, you know, the weather doesn't cooperate, you wait 9 hours and you see what sunset does. And if it doesn't do it, then you come back the next morning and start over. So that was a huge part of it for me was the waiting game. And
but there was just one of you. I'm thinking you got at least two of y'all, right?
Yeah, two, sometimes three people. Okay. This is a PBS documentary film crew. But it's great. You know, we had one experience when we were in Denali. We'd flown to Anchorage, which is not the closest city in the United States. We'd driven many, many hours to the mouth of Denali. We'd been driven in the 90 plus miles on dirt road, mostly dirt road, all the way in to the inholdings there and by Wonder Lake, and had been told that they hadn't seen Denali in two weeks. And this is the tallest mountain. And so we set up the camera. You saw the shot. And on a complete act of faith, we added what's called an intervalometer, which allows you to take time lapse. That is to say, you can compress time by not shooting 24 frames a second, but maybe even 1 second or a frame every 2 seconds. And I don't remember what we'd sat, but we sat there as the clouds went by, and the clouds went by, and then all of a sudden, you know, you can go for an hour and a half, and you still haven't burned through much film. And all of a sudden, something started to clear. And as you saw, just for a second, the entire top of the tallest peak in America was revealed to us through an act of faith. Everybody was hungry. Bugs were going. We'd just gotten there. We were tired. We had every right to sort of, you know, pack it in and hope for a better view the next day, and got one of the greatest time-lapse shots we've ever had.
One of my favorite scenes of the whole series was that, you know, Denali. Me put it in perspective how big that mountain is when you see the bottom and the base, and then it just goes into clouds, and then all of a sudden there's a whole another mountain above it.
I had to reframe that. I mean, I did a shot originally, and I was looking, and I saw these gigantic mountains that were revealed at the bottom, and I figured, well, I'll just double that.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden I started doing some calculations, 20,000 feet, 22,000, you know, and I widened out, and as you see, it's scraping the top of our frame.
Right.
And because we couldn't see it, we had no idea what was going to be revealed, if it was going to be revealed.
I had some other photographers with me on the second visit that I had to Denali, and one of the overlook areas where I had set up to take photographs, and it was all cloudy like it very often is there. And it was a gentleman from Germany, I think, and he was a pretty serious photographer, and he says to me, you know, well, where's the mountain, you know, going to be when it's going to be there? You know, I said, and he's looking out this way, and I said, no, it's more up that way.
Yeah.
You know, I said, it's
bigger than the Alps.
Yeah. And so it was interesting, you know, because you do spend in Alaska a lot of time looking at overcast, cloudy weather, and Denali was exactly the same for me. I think I saw it for 20 minutes, you know, and the entire trip I was there.
So. Yeah.
At the risk of being politically incorrect, I won't call it McKinley, right? I'm supposed to stick with Denali as the name.
Well, you know, it was named after some gold prospectors named it after McKinley just because of the gold standard. And he, William McKinley, a great president elected in 1896 and 1900, was from Ohio and never went to Alaska. So I'm happy to return it back to
return it back to his name.
The great one.
Yeah, yes. Mark, how many people have photographed all 59 of the national parks?
Well, I know of three that have done it in color. I don't know of anyone else that has an entire set in black and white. One of the gentlemen, QT Long, who was featured in the PBS series that Ken did, reached out. We kind of connected on Twitter a couple years ago, and we emailed back and forth a little bit. And he's a wonderful photographer also did a great job. He's actually, I think, done a lot more in-depth photography on a lot of the parks. You know, I'd like to go back to a lot of them and spend more time in some of them, but he's spent a number of years in the parks. But besides QT, I know of two others, and he told me, you know, that same thing just a few weeks ago. We kind of were talking about how many had done that, and he mentioned to me, I think, that you're the only one that's done a black and white collection.
Well, I'm sure you...
It was important to me to do it in black and white for this at the 100-year anniversary, so to be, to me, that bridge again back to the past century.
Well, I'm sure you didn't use a Polaroid or an Instamatic Kodak thing.
Yeah.
Some of y'all don't even know what that is. Anyway, what kind of photography equipment did you use?
That's a great question. And that actually, the project kind of changed a little bit around that. I love large format photography, which is the kind of old cameras that you put the black cloth over your head and you're focusing on the ground glass 4x5 equipment or 8x10 equipment, which I kind of grew up working with. Really learned to appreciate, all the ins and outs of those cameras. And the first 6 to 8 months, I shot a lot of the parks with that, and also shot some of the parks with some medium format digital equipment that was really, really nice. But when I had the first maybe 8 to 10 finished prints images, people would start looking at them, and they would say, their comment would be, well, you must have a really expensive camera, or you must have a really special camera or something. And that was really kind of bothered me, because I'm kind of a purist in photography, and thinking that it's really about the photographer and his eye and, putting the time in to get the photograph and being in the right place. It's not so much about the camera. It is to some extent. But what ended up being the perfect rig for me to be able to carry, for one thing, is I was backpacking a lot with a low pro 50 pounds of cameras on my back. I ended up using Nikon DSLRs, D800Es, which are 36 megapixel. They did a great job, and in the end, that's what I, most every print over there was done with that. Well, actually, every print was done with Nikon equipment, but not every print was done with a D800E. But that was a perfect combination for me of quality, weight, and it also gave me the ability to tell people that, if you have your basic, Canon DSLR, Nikon DSLR, you can do the same thing. It's really about learning how to use the equipment and learning how to see as a photographer more than it is having an expensive camera. So that question always kind of bothered me in the parks when people would say you must have something really special.
Now, Ken, I've got an old Super 8. Millimeter, I don't.
Pretty close, Fred. Okay. We shot Super 16, which is a 16 millimeter film, when all of our colleagues had gone digital. Everything you saw there was shot on motion picture film that's running through a camera at usually 24 frames a second, sometimes more, sometimes less, for slow motion or time lapse. And it's a simple sort of the workhorse of documentaries called an Aton. Camera, it's French, and we've used that for years and years and years, and now are only being persuaded to switch to digital photography of some of our work now. But for those large landscapes, that palette, I loved what film does. It doesn't have all of the detail that Mark is talking about, the megapixels or their equivalent. It has grain, it has other things, but there's something that you capture. So it's not that far away from that Super 8 that you were talking about. It's just the negative size is a little bit about my thumb size. So every image you saw there had to be projected and blown up, and it's fraught with lots of problems. And I live in New Hampshire, and we make maple syrup there. And it takes 40 gallons of sap to make 1 gallon of maple syrup, and that's pretty close to what the shooting ratio was on this film.
Okay, I'll get my battery. There's hope for me yet. I can do this.
Real quick, based on that, because I was one of the last film converts. Also, I'm a big film fan. That's why I love large format photography. But the almost every photograph over there, for any photographers here today, people always talk to me about noise reduction software and this and that. And probably every image in there, I was adding noise to that image. To give it more of an organic look, because that has a more tactile quality to me that I appreciate.
There's a cosmology here that the painters that inspired me and Mark are dealing with pigment on a cellular level. They have to wear smocks to to keep the paint off their clothes. And then the photographers were dealing in chemicals, a kind of molecular process, and you can feel that there's still something tactile. You hold up a negative. Right. And now we work in a digital electronic world in which really your tool, once you've clicked, back later is a mouse. And so you've got a generation removed, and the ways in which we try to intervene with the impersonalness of that, first of all, through these are extraordinary photographs, ladies and gentlemen, that you will be seeing, that are about that time and that effort and that care and that composition, but then how do you find the human dimension? Who sees it? How is it seen? How is it framed? How is it presented? What are you looking for? What combination of both composition but also content that speaks to you? What are the abstract values of it that make it stick out, as you'll see in Arches, in a photograph that Mark has from Arches National Park in Utah? These are all the considerations that we have, and I was taught by still photographers, and what we want to do is turn our motion pictures into still photographs or paintings, and we want to take our old photographs that are a huge component of how we animate our stories and turn them into motion pictures. And the paintings and the still photographs into motion pictures by the way we energetically film them. And so it's sort of the exact opposite. It's counterintuitive, but I think you get a possibility of something developing, no pun intended.
Well, this is some serious work both of you were doing. Okay, there's got to be some funnies that arose during the process of, you know, 10 years and five for you. Mm-hmm. Give us a couple of funnies,
Funnies. I don't know. Probably the bull moose chasing me around a rent a car in Denali.
Wildlife.
That's what I'm getting after.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it, people always would say, you know, how were the bears? You know, in Alaska, the bears actually were really cool in Alaska. They were. You know, I was in Katmai, put into this area. We actually did not. I didn't shoot much in Brooks Falls. I shot in Funnel Creek, it was called, where you're kind of out in the wild. You know, you didn't have the National Park Service Visitor Center restrictions there. And, you know, the float plane landed in a little pond, and you're walking across the tundra with a camera on a tripod over your shoulder and walking up toward the Funnel Creek little river that goes through there. And all of a sudden, the river was down below this little bluff that was maybe 20 feet tall, and as you come up to the crest, there's within the size of a football field maybe 600 to 800 pound Alaska brown bears, you know, down there going back and forth, and you know, at first it's a little intimidating when you know all the stories you hear about the bears and, in Alaska, and so you kind of get a little slow, you know, going to the edge of that, and but they actually were very interesting. They were, of course, there were salmon running at that time, so the bears were all down there, you know, feeding on salmon. And I thought it was interesting watching the way they reacted, because they would all know where you were, and you obviously knew where they were, but they just would kind of do their thing. And some of them walked, you know, from here to the front row past me, and they, you know, when an 800-pound Alaska bear just goes walking by and he kind of turns his head and looks at you, you got to, you know, feel pretty good about things to not want to run, you know, at that time. So
that's what you felt?
Well, but those were what I'm getting to is it was the moose. The funnies would be the moose were always the animals that were chasing me around. And numerous times in Rocky Mountain National Park in Alaska and in Wyoming and Grand Teton, that was, to me, I would tell people, it's not the bears, it's the moose.
Right, it's an immature male moose, 2 or 3 years old, who's just, it's his area.
Very unpredictable.
Yeah, and they're big.
They are big.
You know, it's run-ins with wildlife are the biggest ones. And I think also the photo spot. I mean, you know, to have been a filmmaker for 35 years and to sit there and finally think, aha, we've got the right spot, and then it says inspiration point when the light comes up. That's the biggest thing, you know. We've had lots of run-ins with animals at every single place that we've went, and it's usually terrific.
Yeah.
The amazing thing is how many people you see, just who spend 95% spend their time in the parking lot, the visitor center, or along the main road, speaking not just English, but German and French and Japanese and Spanish. Sometimes you do a survey walking along the south rim of the Grand Canyon, which gets 90, 95% of the visitors, as opposed to the north rim, which is very different. South rim is high desert, north rim is alpine. Mm-hmm. It's just an amazing thing. And you realize how much other nations have not only understood what we've created, but have gone and duplicated it for themselves. I mean, we invented the idea, and it is now seems so obvious, but you have to appreciate, as I hope the introduction of the film says, that this is the first time in human history land is set aside not for rich or noblemen or for kings, but for everybody and for all time. And it could only have happened in the United States, where you were practicing with the act of faith that trusting the people to decide how you're going to run your country is. I mean, it's just a flabbergastingly inspirational thing.
Well, during your filming and making of the film, was there a moment that just sort of grabbed you and just kind of tugged at you and said, there's something really, really unique about this moment?
Yes. It happened all the time with that atomic insignificance that I was speaking about earlier. But I had a situation very early on in the production. I had just buried my father. I had gone to Yosemite to catch up with the film crew, and I suddenly said to them as I arrived that I'd been to a lot of National Park Service sites. You understand there are more than 400 units that are battlefields, and I spent, you know, months of my life in battlefields of the Civil War and other places, historic homes and such. Like, made a film on the Statue of Liberty, all of those things. But I'd never been to a natural national park. I told my comrades as I joined them at Yosemite, and I was already stunned by the views there. And we spent 2 or 3 days filming, climbing up beyond Vernal and Nevada Falls, and the first shot I took when I arrived at Yosemite, I was handed the camera, and I took that tilt down Yosemite Falls that you saw in the introduction, which is just this never-ending, highest free-falling falls in the United States. And you tilt down and you think it's, wow, that's a beautiful falls, and you're only halfway through. And the second half of it continues. It's just amazing. The last night, we were gonna get up very, very early the next morning and go to San Francisco and get on with our busy lives. And as Mark will attest, you know, the world falls away when you're in a national park. You begin to have a kind of different relationship with yourself and whatever is your master. You know, you can call it nature with a capital N, God, faith, spirit, whatever it is. It doesn't actually matter. It's your relationship. And I couldn't get to sleep, and I couldn't understand why, and something was stirring in me, and all of a sudden I realized, oh my God, I had been to a national park before. In 1959, when I was 6 years old, my mother was dying of cancer. My father took me on the only road trip he and I ever went to together. He was largely distracted by my mother's illness and other demons he never quite outran in his too short life. But one Friday afternoon, we were living in Newark, Delaware. He was an anthropologist at the University of Delaware. He said, God took me in the car and we went to Baltimore where he had grown up, and I slept in his bed under his old chenille blanket, and we got up at 4 a.m. I'd never woken up in the dark before, and we went out and we were driving for hours before the sun came up, and we ended up at Front Royal, and he took me up into the Skyline Drive, which is the drive that runs down the spine of a relatively small, modest park, Shenandoah National Park. And we drove through clouds, we saw deer. I'd never driven through a cloud before. We pulled off, we took an impossibly long hike, maybe a half a mile to a little cataract, which I thought was a giant wolf. I could still, that evening at Yosemite, suddenly recall the way his hand felt in mine. And it was hugely meaningful, and I had, it was not a repressed memory, it was just forgotten. The tragedy that was about to overtake my family, all of those things had wiped it out. And yet Yosemite had offered me the space to bring it back into my life. And so when people ask me what's my favorite park, I always say Yosemite. There are places that equal Yosemite, Zion, Glacier, all the Alaska parks. Arches I'm particularly fond of. The Grand Canyon is the grandest canyon on Earth. All of those things have meaning, but the sense that how we receive these is very much tied with who we see them with. and that we pass this down to the generations. And here was this great gift. I recovered my father. I recovered a great deal of who I was in that moment in Yosemite, thinking about a much smaller, less spectacular, if you compare it to Yosemite, but for me, equally as important and equally beautiful thing. And I've now taken my daughters down that same Skyline Drive, forcing, you know, sort of bored teenagers into trying to recreate what this terrified six-year-old experience in 1959. And so I think that's what it is. At the heart of the parks is, as I said before, a human story that made it happen, and now a human story that continues to make it happen. And as we move into a centennial year, we have to realize that, like liberty itself, our vigilance will be required to make sure that this is a machine that will go of itself.
Mark's photography project that you're going to get to see here in a second has already gotten scheduled at the LBJ. Library over in Austin, and
we're going to go up to the last quarter of 2016.
Yep, and going to go up to the George W. Bush Library Center in Dallas.
And a little bit of scaled down version, just some of the photographs, I think, not the historic section that's in there.
But it's good stuff.
Yeah.
All right, we have some time for a little few questions. Anybody want to take on these two? Got one over.
Grizzly Parking. That's a sign I saw at a breakfast place in Glacier National Park and couldn't resist it. And do what? No, I didn't. I bought it at a gift shop. I've never seen one anywhere in actual use, but the Bush Library here now.
We've got some. Go ahead.
I hope I'm loud enough.
I can hear you.
Well, thank you. That's an excellent question, and those people need only to travel to the national park in northwestern Montana that will probably at some point be called the national park formerly known as Glacier. Just in the 10 years that we were attending to it, almost a third of the glaciers, which had already significantly diminished from the 1940s and 50s, where there's fairly accurate scientific sort of accounting of their size. They expand and contract in normal seasons, but this has been real long-term shrinkage. It's noticeable. Places that I've hiked that were covered in snow are now perpetually free of glaciers, and that's, you know, sad evidence. And we'll see some of these very sensitive ecosystems beginning to experience that too. Probably the Everglades, which is our most diverse ecosystem, will begin to experience some effects of rising sea levels. I mean, I think what your question is that in some ways, in a sad way, that won't apply to the museums of patient erosion in Utah or the grandest canyon on Earth, but in some ways, these are the canaries in the mine. Mm-hmm. That the national parks will show very quickly some of these places. It's already happening in Alaska. I'm going back there this coming summer to celebrate part of this.
Yeah, Glacier Bay for me, I just photographed in August, I guess, or September, and just this year, and that really for me was, I was like, well, where are the tidewater glaciers that John Muir wrote about? And you just see miles of dirt pathway where the glaciers were, and in a lot of cases, you can't even, you know, see most of them. There's only three tidewater glaciers, I think, that
yes.
Even touch the water now in Glacier Bay National Park. And, you know, it's very, you know, alarming in a way when you're there looking at something that just from the writings that he had not so long ago and in time, that they're no longer there. You can't see them anymore. So that was interesting to me.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
No, we formed an advisory committee, which I've been extremely thankful to have, and many people on the advisory committee helped, you know, with making contacts to corporations, individual donations. I sold limited edition prints, just whatever kind of a combination of things, you know, to fund the project. But we had some good corporate donations and had some very, very good individual donations as well that kind of, as we moved along, helped the project go. So
I'll put in a word for it. Buy the book when it comes out in the spring. That helps. And also buy some prints.
Yeah.
Because you're going to see some stuff tonight that you're going to actually love. Yes, sir. David, is that you?
Hey, Fred.
Hi, David.
Thanks for having this tonight. This is great. As a photographer, I'm a photographer.
Wait a minute. Let me make this a little bit clearer. Yeah. David Valdez was the president's photographer when the president was president.
You.
Now, yay, David.
Hi, David.
Well, you had an opportunity to photograph all the national parks. I spent 10 years of my life photographing one person.
Mm-hmm.
But I was
monumental,
I was,
though.
Yes, but I was blessed that my work is managed by the U.S. Archives, and it's preserved forever and ever. And then 30 plus other years of my photography work is now housed at the Briscoe Center for American History at the University of Texas. And so as a photographer, I'm very concerned about preserving mm-hmm. the photography for history's sake. I was just curious what you do to house your photography that so 50 years, 100 years from now, mm-hmm. that it'll still be available.
Well, that's a great question, David. I have what I call Centennial Edition. There are limited edition prints, but for the 59 as a whole, I call Centennial Edition. There's 100 sets of those, and they're out of that are 25 artist proof sets that I'm dedicating just to give to the Bush Library. Will get a set. Other institutions like that will get a set. So that, at this point, is all that I know as far as keeping them and getting them in some good hands that can conserve them. But that's a great question. You know, I haven't thought beyond, you know, where they would go from there.
It's a fundamental question for us, sir, as well. We presumed that those ones and zeros would be eternal, but it really determines what kind of instrument is reading those ones and zeros. And so I know of many filmmakers, including myself, that have gone back to film, that have taken digital masters mm-hmm. and made a film copy of it, because despite the relative short life of that, you can't count on those ones and zeros lasting, because we may have to go to some old museum to just find the machine that knows how to read mm-hmm. whatever took that picture 1,000 iterations of sea changes. My original negative of the finished films and their digital masters are several hundred feet below ground at the Eastman House in Rochester, New York, along with some other filmmakers. They asked us, which I considered a real privilege, and that gives us some measure of protection, but mm-hmm. it's not going to be, nothing's going to last forever.
Yes.
You'll find that the history of the national parks has been just this kind of tension, and it's an age-old American tension. You know, what is the role of government? Are we in the business of preserving these places, or should it all be in private hands? And there's been interesting tensions. But I think for the national parks, among a vast majority of Americans, they understand that these are our crown jewels. They don't have to be in the Tower of London. But they are free and open to folks to come and enjoy them, and that it just involves actually your individual stewardship. All it takes is for you to just write that letter, because that's what it took somebody, John Muir or whomever mm-hmm. it was, at each park has a story, and it's interesting. You sort of lift up the rock of that of these parks, and each one has an interesting story where an individual or a group of individuals sort of swam upstream, went against the tide of acquisitiveness that is very much a part of our nature and not in a pejorative sense, and just said, no, let's set this aside. And all we have to be reminded of is those early paintings and photographs. Abraham Lincoln never made it, never saw Yosemite except in the paintings and the photographs that he mm-hmm. was presented. And many of the senators and congressmen who voted to create the early national parks mm-hmm. had never been out west, had never understood their massive beauty, and yet they wanted to protect them for the possibility that future generations would have the ability to go or not go. It's better to go because you are inspirited, but all it needs is your advocacy, just as you might believe in something else, and you would beseech your elected officials to attend to that. And fortunately, I think this is not a partisan thing. Sometimes we permit almost everything to be turned into a red state, blue state kind of issue. And there are aspects of the national parks that do fit very nicely into those kind of extreme narratives. But I think a vast majority of Americans understand that this is an extraordinary inheritance and birthright, and we've got certain obligations to not only ourselves, but our posterity to make sure that they're preserved and taken care of.
Mm-hmm. One more, yes ma'am.
Hungary.
Hungary, yeah.
South Carolina.
I mean, I told him he has to stop, but we did it. But how many more do y'all think? And how did President Bush?
Well, it's a great, great question, and this is a lasting and enduring question. In order to have a natural national park, of which there are only 59, and most recently, just a few years ago, a national monument, and I'll get to that in a second, was converted by an act of Congress. That's what it takes to create a national park in which their protections are more or less inviolate. We can discuss the ways in which people nibble around the edges. But there are more than 400 units, and some of those are seashores and historic sites and battlefields. It's to our great ever-loving credit that we've been willing to include all of American history. We've lifted up the carpet and we've swept up. We have plantation houses, but also slave cabins of the lives of the people who made the comfortable life of the slave owner possible. We have Sand Creek and Washita on the Great Plains, sites of massacres of unarmed Indian women and children by United States cavalrymen, part of it. Central High School, still a working inner city high school, is a National Park Service site. So is Shanksville, Pennsylvania.
The White House.
The White House itself, the Washington Monument. We have embraced the totality of our history. I know of no other country that's willing to also shine a light on aspects of its history that's complicated and makes us go back on ourselves. So the question is whether there would be political will and interest to convert national monuments, which presidents can designate through the Antiquities Act, the greatest gift Congress has ever given the executive ever, that allows them to set aside for historic or scientific purposes tracts of land. Devil's Tower was the first, Muir Woods. No one expected Theodore Roosevelt. These were all small tracts of 5,000 acres. Nobody expected 880,000 Theodore Roosevelt trying to protect the Grand Canyon that later got converted. So we would see the possibility over time slowed down that land would be converted to national parks sparingly. Maybe a national monument would graduate. Maybe you might even find, I've talked to Senator Orrin Hatch about a place that he's particularly, Dead Horse Point in Utah, which sits between Arches National Park and mm-hmm. Canyonlands. It's a spectacular place, and whether that ought to just bypass everything and go from a Utah state park to a national park. And if his will was behind it, I think you'd find the possibility of that taking place. But other land can be protected in other ways, and people are doing that all the time. It's just whether we will be adding significantly to that 59 natural national parks. Pinnacles, as I said, was just a few years ago converted. But I think it will be few and far between. The other thing is, remember, we have the government owns vast tracts of land that are national forests. National forests are in the agriculture department. Think crops. National parks are in interior, think sanctuaries and protected. And so you could also see national forests being transferred from agriculture to interior and then perhaps graduating to that status. But this takes extraordinary will and kind of common purpose, which obviously we haven't seen much of in Washington. Don't end on that. Not on a downer.
Oh, yeah, let's get an upper. All right, come on. Yes, sir. We're talking about downer.
I think as the purity of ideology, you know, I remember I asked Shelby Foote why the Civil War happened. I'd asked a lot of historians, and I got these long, convoluted answers. And he said, the Civil War happened because we failed to do what Americans are good at. We like to think of ourselves as uncompromising people, but our genius is for compromise. And when it broke down, we murdered 750,000 of our own people. It tells you a little bit about the rigidity of ideology in a country in which politics, as George Will told me in a film about Thomas Jefferson, is the politics of the half-loaf. You never get anything. But now we got some characters who want everything, and there's a kind of ideological test, and the Antiquities Act doesn't pass that smell test of the purists. And so what we have to do is just re-remind ourselves that we're in a great centering process, you know, that we don't gyrate too much, that this is, the national parks particularly represent the strength of our commonwealth, and that's an important thing. And yes, for ideological purists, the Antiquities Act ought to be taken away. It represents an excess of executive power, but I would tell them that it was sponsored by a man named Lacey from Iowa who lived nowhere near any of the national parks and monuments he was trying to save. And he was trying to save birds and game, and he helped pass the Bird and Game Act, and he was a very conservative Republican when conservative meant conservation and about saving these things for posterity, realizing there were certain values to the American dream. And the Antiquities Act was given to President Theodore Roosevelt with just that intention, that the executive ought to be able to step in when certain interests that would be detrimental to the people needed to be protected, like Devil's Tower or Muir Woods or the many other monuments that exist, and that time for the legislative process to work its will and to do the full protections that the national parks enjoy, there wasn't enough time. And I think it's a wonderful act. It has not been abused. I think President Obama has invoked it for undersea marine areas near the Marianas Islands to protect reefs there.
Thank you all for being here. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now, if you would, ladies and gentlemen, kind of stay in your area, we will allow the bushes to depart, and then we'll go across the plaza, have some refreshments, and look at some really awesome photography. Thank you, guys.